live from the floor of Worldcon 74. Sci-Fi for Me TV presents coverage of the 74th Annual World Science Fiction Convention.
Hi folks, I'm Timothy Harvey, and this is Sci-Fi for Me's coverage of Worldcon 74, the Mid-America Con 2, yes, thank you. The last time I was here in Kansas City was 40 years ago, and one of the big highlights of that particular event was the promotion of a little tiny film called Star Wars.
I hear it might have done something
decent. It got a few good reviews and managed to make its budget back. We've got a little mic problem here. We're going to have Dan readjust. Anyway, this is our last segment of the evening, live streaming out into the world. We'd like to thank, of course, our folks over at TV25 who are handling the TV side of things. But most of all, we'd like to talk about Sprint for a second. They are our major sponsor in this endeavor of ours to bring live streaming to WorldCon. Network reliability within 1% of Verizon. Sprint saves you almost 50% of most Verizon, AT&T, and T-Mobile rates. Don't let a 1% difference cost you twice as much. Switch to Sprint, and the hashtag they're using is the switch is real. So we hope you'll check that out. And again, thank you very much to the fine folks at Sprint who made it possible for us to get online and out. We are broadcasting from inside a big convention center, knows that it's a giant big box, which is not conducive for getting a signal out. So the folks at Sprint took care of us very, very well.
Yeah, we just had a little audio issue here. Now, we just let people know we've had our audio issues.
Oh, yes.
We've had different issues out here. A lot of it was compression on our end, a server going down, you know, that kind of thing. But the one thing we have been able to rely upon is Sprint.
Yes, so that's this is a very experimental thing that we're doing here. And it's never been done at WorldCon. It's never been done really anywhere, as far as anyone can tell. Coming in and having the kind of interaction that we're able to have with both the guests at the convention but also a lot of the writers and the folks who are working here on panels, it is a very cool thing that we're getting to try and do here.
And it is using actually a 4G LTE signal, just like what people would use
right. To
download, to stream your favorite TV shows on your phone. And we're doing full broadcast on this. That says something for the network.
So for those of you who have been following us for the last couple of days, you've seen us have a very successful run on some of these, and some of these where things have gotten a little wonky. You know, if the technology doesn't let you down every now and again, that's the plot of many a science fiction film anyway.
But thank you, Sprint, for not being part of that problem.
Right.
Yes.
So anyway, now that we basically provided a pretty sizable commercial for our friends at Sprint. You're welcome, guys. The neat thing about this convention is what is not being seen on the floor right now. If Jason were to turn the camera around and show what's going on the floor right now, it looks pretty quiet. Okay? This is a very open-looking space with not a lot of people, right? The difference is that where the action is actually not on the convention floor. It's actually downstairs and across the hall at the panels. Mm-hmm. Unlike, say, your Comic-Con or your, whether it's, you know, any Comic-Con, really, or here it's Planet Comic-Con and KC Comic-Con, which you very much, this space is full of vendors. And we have vendors over there, although the vendors are done for the night. But the vendor focus over here has been books, and art, and sculpture, and things like that, you know, things you can actually touch and real kind of tangible, genre-related, in some cases, but there's a beautiful jewelry work over there as well.
Mm-hmm.
But ordinarily, this would be, if it was one of those conventions, it would be wall-to-wall vendors.
Yes.
You'd have a row of tables over there for people to sign books, and you'd meet celebrities and that sort of thing.
And
the celebrities are mingling here.
And artists and writers at a standard Comic-Con would be all over the place selling books
right. And
art and that type of thing, not just greeting people and signing. They are actually vendors themselves.
Right. And we do have some of that going over here in the portion of the floor that is actually the vendors. But it is much more a focus on the panels and the learning portion of this. It's a literary award. The Hugo Awards are a literary award. WorldCon is essentially a literary convention. So you have
published.
You have a lot of publishers here. You have a lot of authors here. George R. R. Martin walks by our booth two or three times a day. We smile and wave.
Still haven't gotten him for an interview.
Yeah, right? we
working on that.
I have a plan. We're gonna have Maya. If you've been watching, you know, she's been doing a lot of reporting for us. I'm gonna have Maya throw herself in front of George R. R. Martin, and then when he stops in shock, what this person is doing, she's gonna roll over and beg him to come over and give us an interview. That's my plan, and we'll see if that actually happens. I've told her this. I believe that the eye rolling was a signal that she is on board with this plan. Right? So
we assume that.
And Maya is right over there. And
yes,
she has suddenly realized we've been discussing her. Everything's fine, Maya. Everything's fine. Don't you worry about anything. It's all Dan's fault. Right.
As I'm here to take blame.
There you go. That's why. Thank you. Thank you. We need someone to take the blame.
Lesson in life, always have somebody to blame.
Right. So we have been filming a lot of author interviews today. We've been filming a lot of just folks here on at the convention, whether they be authors or publishers or some of the folks who are bidding for the 2018
right.
WorldCon, because several cities are trying to get that to go there after next year's con in Helsinki. So we will have those up on the website. Hopefully we'll actually be able to stream some of those tomorrow. We want to do some editing and that sort of thing and package them a little bit cleaner. But we'll hopefully have those out for you soon. Certainly they're going to be up on the website and up on our YouTube channel very, very soon. We do want to talk a little bit about some of the panels. Now, we've had a chance, with the exception of Jason, who our fearless leader, who basically has been chained to this booth with the rare exceptions that I've dragged him off to feed him. A lot of us have been heading off to panels and getting a chance to sit down and listen to what... a lot of different topics, really. There's a range.
Oh, yes.
There's a huge range. Every
huge range.
Hour has our little con book here. Every hour has page. There's page after page of panels that are happening. There's not enough of us.
And it's something that we're not really quite used to, because at a like Planet Comic Con, you've got at most 6 panels going on at one time.
Right. And if your really, really big ones are your big author, your big star, you know, your mm-hmm. you know, Cary Elwes was here, and of course packed the room, and you know, it's the kind of thing where your celebrities are your big draws, right? Your big name actors and your cultural,
it's,
you know, hits.
That's the nature of those types of conventions, though. It's the
right.
it's the immersive carnival atmosphere. It's
right.
it's the big bang type of atmosphere.
And that is really, really cool, because you get a chance to talk to these folks and hear their stories. This is a completely different vibe. So this, like mm-hmm. I said, this is, you look around this room here, it's very quiet, but downstairs at these panels, a lot of them are packed.
Oh,
some
yeah.
of them are standing room only.
And people are engaged in these
oh,
panels.
Yeah.
A lot of times you'll see at the Comic Cons, you'll find a 150-seat room with 20 people in it,
right.
And you might get one or two questions from the crowd that most of the people are there just out of maybe curiosity, mm-hmm. or maybe they just need a break from the floor or something, and that's their excuse to do it. But on this one, people are actually engaged in these panels, and there are so many panels.
I know.
That's why it's so crowded out there and sparse in here.
Right. If you've ever been to Bartle Hall, there's a long walkway from the main entrance that basically comes up to the escalators mm-hmm. and the stairs. And that hallway for a Planet Comic Con or a KC Comic Con here is usually just people walking. You know, that's it.
Yep.
But the hallway actually has branches. There's other halls, and they are full of rooms. I had no idea.
Surprise.
We never go there.
Well, I've passed by them, but I've never seen them used.
And they are just packed. So anyway, it's a completely different vibe. Now, you have been to a couple of different panels today.
I have.
And I have not got to get into any panels today. So tell me about the panels. Tell me about the panels you've been to.
I feel sorry for you.
Well, I feel sorry for me, too. My life is not sad. But no, seriously, what did you get a chance to see today?
Well, I'm more focusing on science and technology for the most part. Now, I did see a cyberpunk one earlier, which I spoke with Jason about earlier on air. Not too long ago, I saw one this afternoon. I saw one on artificial intelligence. Is it dangerous?
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't really the scientific panel I hoped for. It was a few science fiction writers speculating, and there was really nothing new came out of it.
Mm.
So, but I did go see a science-based one on spacecraft propulsion.
Uh-huh.
Where we're going with that. That type of thing. And they were, the moderator and three panelists were quite literally all rocket scientists.
Hey.
So it's appropriate. It wasn't just, you know, some people speculating from the science fiction
right.
field. These are people who have actually been designing and leading these
teams. Well, and that's one of the things I've noticed about the panels here is that the people who are on the panels generally tend to be really, really relevant. And this is not knocking anybody out, any other conventions, panels, or anything like that.
Right.
But this is, there's an education focus to this. The James Gunn Center on the Study of Science Fiction out in Lawrence, Kansas at
KU
is, has been really, really involved with developing the program for the panels this year. So there's, right. they're coming from an education standpoint. They're coming from a teaching standpoint. The idea that people should learn something as they come away from this.
Right.
And if you have a chance to ever look at the guide, and we'll put a link up to the list of what is happening this week with this is, you know, so much of this is, some of it's a lot of fun. Some of it's very silly.
Yes. Yeah.
And
absolutely.
I was talking to a guy who's been to several of these over the years. Who just happened to be downstairs and. Walked up the hallway and started up a conversation. People are really nice. And he was talking about how back when they had, when Next Generation had first come on, this is one of the, this is how long ago this is, it was like year one. And
late
they
80s.
Actually had a panel at one of the World Cons was 101 ways to get rid of Wesley Crusher. And it was a serious panel on how to do away with the teenage character of Wesley Crusher. And he had me, I was laughing so hard on the way back up here. But a lot of it is very, very serious and very considered, kind of in the way that it's, you know, it's a discussion, but it's also an education kind of thing.
There is, and you mentioned the entertainment side. Like yesterday, since you were broadcasting, I sat in on the Doctor Who panel.
Right.
And basically, basically all it was a few people who were speculating on the transition from Stephen Moffat to Chris Chibnall.
Sure.
Talking about their stylistic differences, what's the same, what they'd like to see, what they expect, what they hope, mm-hmm. what they're scared of seeing, you know, this type of thing. So, I mean, yeah, it runs the gamut. Now, talking about academic stuff, now, again, I was a little disappointed with the artificial intelligence as there was nobody in the artificial intelligence field
sure.
to cover that aspect. It was merely speculation of fictional writers, which, you know, yeah.
Well, writers are fiction. The writers themselves weren't fictional.
Were they? That's the thing. No, it's
did they fade away when you weren't looking.
Yeah, right. Something like that. But well, I haven't seen any of them rocking around, so you never know. But it's yeah, some different things in the news came about. But for the most part, it was nothing really new.
Sure.
I probably did more in my one article on artificial intelligence that in terms of speculation than what they did. But. But the one that I went to on the... I went to a couple other science ones.
Sure.
One or two of these guys were also on those. For some strange reason, things like faster light travel, time travel, these things, they were able to take interesting subjects and make them boring. This time, they took an interesting subject and kept it interesting. I liked it. Because on this, they're talking about, you know, we're going to the stars.
Right.
You know, or at least other planets.
Right.
You know, we can't just stay here. What are we going to do there? Now, most of the content, I should say, which is about half the panel itself, was about what we're working on now. Mm-hmm. Just kind of a rundown. Sails.
Solar sails, sure.
We're going back to sailing,
mm-hmm.
pretty much. Well, they cover two things. One was laser sails.
Right.
You can use like a 100 megawatt laser on a particular sail to get it to a respectable percentage of the speed of light.
Right.
Now that respectable percentage pretty much maxes out at 10%. So
right.
if you do the math, to get to the nearest star, Proxima Centauri, will take 40 years.
Right, because it's 4 light years away.
Exactly. And
right.
then it would take another 4 years before we knew we made it. You know?
Right.
And so... Where the practicality is on that, I don't know, but it's good to know that we can. So interplanetary, that should be a really good deal.
Sure. And you know what's interesting about that is that when we were, if you scale it down and you have the folks who were sending across an ocean, they didn't know how far it was across.
Right.
And those voyages would take months.
Yes.
And there was a viewpoint in those days of exploration, you know, where you would half expect to not come back.
Right.
You know, there was a hope, obviously, But it was a different way of looking at things. And I'm not going to say we've lost that, because the world was very, very different and things are complete. You know, things change.
Yeah.
Obviously, we don't have to do so much of that now. But when you're looking, I mean, there's a reason they call it like a sea of stars. You know, it's
exactly.
You know, the ocean of night. You know,
right.
I mean, it's kind of the same thing.
It is the final frontier.
Right.
Well, unless you want to go hyper dimensions, but then that's something completely different.
Well, sure.
That's a completely different frontier.
Yeah.
But we're back to the sales. The laser sale is again a pretty good, I would say, interplanetary. They're talking interstellar.
Mm-hmm.
More power to them.
Certainly interplanetary. I mean, you know, what's the travel time to Mars now? What is it?
It all depends on where it is in its orbit. I mean, it's anywhere from a couple months to 9 months. I think 9 months is what they speculate on a travel. That's what they plan for.
Sure.
There's that. There's the solar cell, which you brought up, where it's actually taking sunlight to move it. And what they're using that for, I believe they said they've got a launch coming next June of a test vehicle. It's the Near Earth Asteroid Scout.
Oh, cool.
And so they're going to be exploring asteroids, not only for future mining, mm-hmm. also to protect us.
Wait. They haven't made any movies about asteroids hitting us, have they?
Somebody might have thought of a story or something.
Someone should write one of those, because, I mean, remind me of something there.
Neil deGrasse Tyson said it best, saying that asteroids are nature's way of saying, how's that space program coming along? So, but I mean,
like that.
I mean, one of the panelists who headed up one of the projects for NASA for a few years really said that nuclear thermal propulsion, in terms of cost savings, is the ideal way. Now
I heard about this back in I want to say it was the 70s or 80s. This was a big proposal that everyone sat there and looked very pale when you discuss it.
Because nuclear.
Like, so what? You're supposed to you strap a ship onto basically a nuclear bomb dispenser, and then you just blow them up.
Yeah.
Your giant plate in between the crew cabin and the explosion. And it's also a pretty powerful push.
It is, but also one of the things that scares people is the radiation.
Sure.
But the thing is, the unenriched uranium, the non-weapons grade uranium,
right.
was used in so many colleges up until 9/11, powering nuclear reactors.
Right.
And they are so low radiation, they're not anything to worry about. It doesn't become super radioactive until they flip the switch on.
And so
by sending it up into space, mm-hmm. assembling it there, and then launching it, we're safe. So the theory goes.
So, and wouldn't you also, because space is full of a lot of radiation, which is not good for humans as it is.
Yeah.
I mean, and so anytime you're going to, if you want to go anywhere, if you want to do like a mission to Mars or anywhere further out than that, you've got to take into the background radiation.
Yes.
Into effect, like gamma rays. And this is not the kind of stuff that turns you into the Hulk, kids. This is the kind of stuff that makes you dead. There's all kinds of interstellar radiation, solar floating around the solar system, which is not good for people.
And even just infrared, not infrared, but ultraviolet.
Yeah.
Ultraviolet range, which we're largely protected from.
With the atmosphere,
here.
Right?
Yeah.
So if you're going to put somebody in a metal can and shoot them at Mars, you're going to end it with a trip over months. You're going to have to shield them pretty well anyway. So
you've got many layers of air and mylar.
Yeah. You know, hopefully that would help minimize it. Is anybody seriously working on atomic propulsion right now? Or?
That they didn't say whether it was being worked on. It was simply the proposal that he said because
sure.
it was for cost effectiveness. Now one of the other panelists said that there was another cost effective way by using liquid propulsion. Now the idea of just putting it all into one tank and firing it up,
right.
not very good. But if you refuel early and often and send them up in little pieces, basically what they originally speculated back in the early 80s, what the cost would be with reusable rockets.
Sure, right.
It's already cheaper to do that now without the rockets. The technology, because of SpaceX and Photon
sure,
and these,
yeah.
these and these groups, have brought the cost down. So that's a possibility of using, kerosene, chemical, hydrogen peroxide-based.
Well, and some of this stuff is the kind of stuff you could actually refuel at Mars, or you could refuel along the way, because some of this stuff is actually plentiful in the solar system itself.
Right.
You just have to know this where is where we have to stop to pick it up.
And you got
to
refine it for that purpose, too.
Right.
So that,
well, and wasn't that, hasn't that been some of the speculation about how we're going to actually do anything with Mars that's going to be sustainable, is that you would basically have to build a little refueling factory there. Right. So that if you're going, because I mean, obviously, it's entirely possible that you could have a mission that is sold and people agree to do it, which is billed as a one-way trip.
Right.
But I think that they're, it's certainly from a PR standpoint, if nothing else, they're going to sit there and go, yes, we're going to bring it back. you know, the Martian aside, and the dramatic, you know, it's a cool book and a good movie, but there is a certain, like I said, we don't have that mindset that says, if we go and we don't come back, you know, that's just the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
We obviously want our astronauts to come back, and the kind of people who we would send to be the first people on Mars are the kind of people we don't want to get rid of,
right,
necessarily. Unless we go, you know, the Botany Bay route, and it's like, okay, we're going to toss the bus. That's a movie plot right
or,
there,
or
too.
We just call it the Australia route.
Yeah, yeah.
I just call it how you do with our criminals.
Probably not going to be an easy sell on that one. people are going to object, but...
Yeah. A couple things. Something else they talked about was tethers, basically
tethers.
Ropes in space.
Uh-huh.
You know, where you go up and you can latch on and it flings you.
Oh, okay.
And if they could send an electrical current down that tether, mm-hmm, to the ship, it can use electromagnetics to push itself away from the Earth.
That's
as well.
Interesting. Well, because isn't one of the biggest problems, I mean, first of all, you got the problem of escaping the gravity well that is Earth.
Exactly.
And then, of course, the sun is a giant gravity well.
Yes.
And you are going against, you're leaving Earth, you're pushing against the sun,
mm-hmm,
and you want to accelerate so you're not out there forever, and then you have to decelerate.
Right.
So it requires a lot of energy. I hadn't thought of tethers. Does this have anything to do with, is there any connection to that, to like the giant space towers they've been talking about building from time to time?
Actually, no.
Okay.
That was something else, and that was discussed in a previous deal that I saw.
Okay.
Now, the towers are actually not as feasible as you would think. You know, the space elevator kind
right,
of thing.
Yeah.
This is actually something different where you probably... They didn't really specify how the tethers would be tethered into space.
What they attached to, yeah.
But in my mind, because they talked about the flinging effect, I'm sitting here about 2001... in my head with a spinning wheel,
sure,
space,
yeah,
station. So, but I mean, they're
we're a little behind on that.
Yeah, we are. Just a hair. But I figure if they're throwing out the tethers, I assume they've got a way to tether,
yeah,
it out there.
I would have to,
you
think
would assume.
So. We'll have to look into that. That sounds like an article.
Oh, could be.
Yeah.
I think that's a hint.
Okay.
Well, one of us will probably get to it. Also, they talked about something that was tried by DARPA.
Okay.
The Defense Advanced Research Projects Administration. It's basically they came up with the early form of the internet. All right,
right. They've done a lot of robotics work lately,
yes,
too.
They, yeah. Every year they have the DARPA Challenge,
right,
with the robotics. So and I've covered that before, but something that DARPA tried was just for, you know, a kind of a satellite thing. Shoot it up, takes pictures, comes back down.
Okay.
Well. They did a test launching it from an F-15,
mm-hmm,
where it gets some velocity, gets up there, comes
sure,
back down,
right,
that type of thing. And the the brilliant minds of the military used a combination of nitrous oxide and acetylene for their fuel.
This sounds like an explosion.
You would be right.
Okay.
Because basically they
got acetylene and like torches, boom.
With the NO2, you know.
Yeah.
So I mean, they got it to where they could work with it. They instead of storing in tanks, they refuel it on the tarmac before loading it up.
Okay.
There's just one thing that didn't work out. When that thing fired, it didn't stay in the nozzle. It went up the pipe,
oh, no,
to the tank.
Oh no! Ouch.
Oops. So,
was this like an unmanned thing? This was a drone?
It was unmanned,
okay,
drone.
Because I don't remember hearing about losing, yeah, another pilot for that. But,
ladies and gentlemen, our tax dollars at work.
Well, okay. But there is something to be said for building things that go boom.
Yes,
I mean,
there is.
So
if not just for
so
the excitement.
So what did they take from that? I mean, what is that... is that where they are right now? Or is it, did they got a new plan for that? Or?
I believe that was just a kind of an experiment. They never really went into it any further to say if they were working on a new fuel, a new method of doing it, because it is an interesting concept. You got to deploy fast to get photographs to an area. You can't just kind of rework a satellite's orbit. But if you send up, say, an F-15, you know, fired off like a missile, takes the pictures, comes back, boom, we're good. It does make sense.
Sure.
And then one other thing they talked about is not the propulsion itself, but stopping. They talked about aerobraking.
Right.
If you ever saw 2010, which we're a little behind on, just a tad, we actually saw aerobraking in action. Now, they never mentioned this in there, but as soon as they said aerobraking, I said, that was the Leonov. You know, in orbit around Jupiter.
And for those of you who are not aware that there was a film called 2010, because 2001 tends to overpower it a bit, and it doesn't. 2010 certainly didn't have the cultural impact. It's not a bad science fiction film, and it
explained a lot from the first one.
It does, and I think that may have been an issue for folks, because there's a certain mystery to 2001 which you don't necessarily want to lose.
Right.
But it's a solid science fiction film with some interesting ideas, and especially, I don't know, with the tensions we have with Russia right now, it kind of takes place in the end of the Soviet... The Soviet Union's around a lot longer in the movie than it was in our life.
If the Soviet Union had stuck around, we may have actually made it to Jupiter.
Maybe.
Because, you know, once the Soviet Union fell, we didn't have the motivation.
Right, yeah, there goes the arms race. Which is, I'm fine with the arms race part being done, but there was a lot of technological advances that happened because of it that, you know, had some benefit. Yeah.
But they've also got a second variation of it that they're looking at, a magnetic version, what they call a magneto shell.
Okay.
So you can use magnetization with the ions in the atmosphere, so it doesn't actually have to go into the upper atmosphere of a planet to break.
Now, so is this theoretical technology right now?
It is theoretical. It is theoretical. It looks good on paper.
Sure.
But just like they said in 2010, that the people who worked on paper aren't here. but the thing is,
math might be a little more accurate if you strap the mathematicians in. And
exactly. It's nothing so concentrates the mind as the concept of hanging, as the saying goes.
Yeah.
But in that movie, they had to have the heat shielding because they went through the upper atmosphere in order to use that as a brake.
Right.
But by doing it electromagnetically, they don't have that friction. They don't have to have the heat shield.
Interesting. Okay.
And so that's kind of what's being worked on now. And they basically talked about two things in the science fiction looking in the future. Now, they did mention like antimatter, but they just talked about, that's going to take a few miracles. And yeah, that's true. They've gotten because not in the panel on the side, I can tell you that the last I read, they were able to sustain antimatter for 16 seconds.
Which, believe it or not, is a really big deal.
Which is a huge deal, because before it was literally milliseconds is the best they could do. To hold it for 16 seconds is an eternity compared to what it was before.
But it's still, it's certainly not a viable fuel of any kind. I mean, you can't really use it.
It's perfect in theory. In practice, we just got to figure out how to produce it and sustain it.
It's a great science fiction thing. But unfortunately, it is science fiction.
But they did talk about fusion.
Uh-huh.
Using nuclear fusion, similar to the nuclear fission reactor. Fusion is basically, it's a cost savings. It's very efficient. That's the concept.
Is this when they say fusion? Are they talking about the same thing? It's something separate from cold fusion, which is sort of that elusive pipe dream of.
Cold fusion is something completely different. What cold fusion was? It was. There was supposedly an experiment which people have
not been able to duplicate.
What they were able to do was using pulling hydrogen from water using, I believe it was nickel, platinum or palladium. It was palladium, nickel, or maybe it was one other one. I can't remember these metals. And what they were able to do was, all right, nuclear fission takes a lot of heat to start. Mm-hmm. A hydrogen bomb is a fusion bomb, but it requires a fission reaction to start it because it requires so much heat. So it's like an A bomb inside of a bigger bomb. But the thing is, fusion requires heat. But the reason why it was called cold fusion is they supposedly did it at room temperature.
Right.
It was still a hot reaction, but they were able to start it up at room temperature, so they called it cold fusion. And again, nobody's been able to reproduce it.
And that actually requires a lot less energy to do, right? Is that my understanding is that it basically you actually end up getting, you don't have to throw in so much energy that it's counterproductive.
Right.
Is that the idea?
Well,
okay.
That's the idea. Well, the thing about fusion, it requires so much energy to get started. But once it's started, now it's theoretical. They've gotten one experiment to where it was very efficient, but only lasted, what, a second?
Yeah.
You know? But they're getting it there, not quite there yet. But in theory, you know, as far as anybody can tell, it's a very efficient method.
A lot of this stuff, I mean, it's very very fascinating, and you can find a lot of this information on science websites and on the internet and things like that. The math is amazing and very elegant and very very
yes.
cool. But you run into that thing where so much of what you can see it from here, but the tools you need to get it. It's like looking across like a chasm, and you need to build a rope bridge.
Exactly.
And you've got a shoelace. You need a little something a little heavier than that. So
it looks great on paper, but the people who put it on paper aren't here. The other thing they mentioned was one of the physicists up there talked about. Well, somebody said, well, why not? You know, photon recycling. You know,
okay.
You shoot a laser, and instead of just bouncing off a sail, it comes off the sail, bounces back to a mirror, back to the sail, back to, you know, this type of thing.
Okay.
And he talked about the inherent problems with that, you know, that there are inherent. He didn't really go into detail of the inherent problems, but some of them.
Okay, interesting.
Some of them should be fairly clear, because, I mean, lasers are only so precise. They do lose
cohesion.
Cohesion over. Because, I mean, there was a mini maker fair back in 2010. They were talking about, you know, the space elevator thing.
Yeah.
And there was a DARPA project,
mm-hmm.
to figure out an elevator that can make that trip.
Right.
And I talked to some guys out there who had their own version,
mm-hmm.
using was basically a laser and a solar cell.
Okay.
And it was a small laser, but they had this margin of error, because when it's at the highest peak, that's how wide the beam is.
Right.
And so when you're trying to bounce that back and forth and it's expanding, you're going to be losing cohesion.
Oh, sure. And then you're going to lose energy that way, too.
That's my...
Interesting. Okay.
That's my notice on it. That's
well,
not
but,
what he is explaining.
But so. if your goal is to use the laser to hit the sail and there drive the sail forward...
Right.
I wonder... I have no idea. Okay, so part of my brain says
it's all speculation.
Shouldn't you be able to? I mean, shouldn't you get at least a little bit out of every laser shot then? Because you'd be bouncing it a few times. You'd still
right.
get a little thrust.
Right.
Before, I don't know.
I would say theoretically
or
yes.
Or would it be
but
a constant thing? I don't know the technology well enough. So
right, I don't know either. And you're looking at 100 milliwatt laser plus.
Yeah.
And so you're bouncing that heat right back to
the
source.
What are you using to generate that power consistently?
Right.
That's a lot of power to generate. So.
So, and I mean that's pretty much the gist of what they talked about throughout the throughout that particular panel. So,
well, cool. What did you have you looked at what's coming up tomorrow for what you want to?
I briefly glanced.
It's kind of overwhelming.
It's like every day in the morning. We look at the book. All right, what am I doing today?
I know. You it's
know?
Like okay, so
there's so much to look through.
I mean, and we're broadcasting this around 7 p.m. Central Time, and there are things going on right now. There are things going on till 9 o'clock tonight, and there's the space behind us here, or in front of us here, across the night is going to be a big party tonight. It was a big party last night, and hey, WorldCon people have a good time.
Oh,
I
yeah.
cannot tell you they were clearly having a lot of fun, but 10 o'clock. Let me give you an example here. 10 o'clock tomorrow, we have 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. There are 30 things going on from 10 to 11 tomorrow.
That is the early.
30.
The
okay?
early ones.
That's just a small scale of what we're trying to cover today, this. And what, I mean, we sat there earlier today, and I'm looking at the list, and I said, okay, these three. Let's try and get to these three. So, but it's a, like I said, it's an amazing list of stuff. Now, I just want to, and I don't want to spend a whole lot of time having you guys watch me read, but there are a couple of things here. There's an 8:30 a.m. Stroll with the Stars, Farm to Table. But there's a 10 o'clock is a meet and greet for artists. There's a game. The game. We've got a big gaming center over here. They're going to do the Star Wars Trench Run.
Yes.
There's a lot of gaming stuff going on in the morning. So there's a role playing Dungeons and Dragons, Star Wars.
It's like earlier today there was
Call of Cthulhu.
There was a Pokemon Go gathering this morning.
Yeah.
Apparently.
So a lot of the and that's like there's like five different gaming events first thing in the morning. There's a whole bunch of autograph stuff, but there's contracts for writers. Complexity of Character, Flash Fiction, Short but Not Easy, Dark Side of Fairy Tales, Finding a Voice in Podcasts and Audiobooks. The audiobook world has exploded and podcasts have exploded. I listen to a lot of podcasts. My day gig involves me driving around a lot. The One True Love Narrative Trap in Young Adult Fiction.
Oh, geez.
Okay. So if you've ever seen the 40,000 young adult films that have been, or young adult books that have been turned into films in the last 5 years, thank you, Hunger Games. well, okay, we can't blame. No, Hunger Games was actually pretty good. Thank you, Twilight. to all our Twilight fans watching the show, we appreciate that you enjoy the show.
We love you.
We do.
We just have different tastes.
Right. That's Sigma planning the Sigma Forum, science fiction writers who offer futurism to U.S. government. So we have folks whose job it is to talk to the U.S. about science, fiction, finding the right podcast, cloaks, robes, and capes, because, you know, if you got to have a cloak and robe cape, you got to, you know, do it right.
Can't be a superhero without a cape.
There's readings from artists, social issues in recent comics, which, considering the wide range of stuff that's out there in comic books right now, you can get anything from your basic, you know, superhero, horror, western. But there's also comics that are just dramas.
Yep.
And so they're political comics. There's all kinds of stuff. So that's if you're, especially in the independent comic realm, there's a lot of folks who are just playing in all kinds of different ways. Small presses and magazines, alienation and science fiction.
This is only during 1 hour.
This is 10 to 11.
That's the first session.
The Mid-American Con blood drive, by the way. Folks, they've been out here doing a really great job, and people have been going off and giving blood. Yes, Robert Heinlein started that. So it is, just a reminder here that this is the science fiction community is a community, and these people actually, you know, you see people who are getting together, they see each other every year. This might be the only place they see each other. But they're traveling in from all around the country. And one of the things that a lot of these folks really matter to is taking care of the community that they are, that is their own community, this larger community, and the communities they're in. So there are folks who are coming here from all over the country and all over the world who are giving blood in Kansas City because it's the right thing to do. So it's really pretty. It's really amazing.
And kind of along this line, going back to the compare contrast conventions.
Yeah.
Your Comic Cons. You know, basically the convention ends like 7 to 8 at night.
Right.
It's an entire carnival type atmosphere all day.
Mm-hmm.
This one here, it's very business through the day, but they let loose at night and it goes late. So
yeah.
I mean,
oh yeah, this room that will be open in here, and we're not going to stay that late tonight. Well, not here. We're broadcasting. We might go over and party, but. Like I said, that entire side of the room is just going to be one giant party.
Yep.
And till very late in the morning. And they're going to turn around and be back here first thing, bright and early.
And one of the 30 panels at 10 o'clock.
But there's a bunch of stuff here for kids. Like I said, that's just one hour. The whole day is like that. It's been like that. It really ramped up yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And today was really pretty busy. Like I said, but it's been very interesting to be up here and look at the crowds. And they kind of go through waves where you've got, especially first thing in the morning.
Especially with that, we're getting into the weekend as well.
Right, yeah.